Complications in Early Pregnancy Part 2. In this second installment of Complications in Early Pregnancy, we will continue to discuss the other common causes of bleeding in early pregnancy. The learning objectives are to learn to diagnose and assess the severity of common complications in early pregnancy, to provide a list of differential diagnoses for common complaints in early pregnancy, and to learn to manage these complications in early pregnancy. Ectopic pregnancy. The classic triad of an ectopic pregnancy includes amenorrhea, lower abdominal pain, and pervaginal bleeding. In the history-taking process, if any patient presents with the above features and there is suspicion of ectopic pregnancy, risk factors should be searched for. These include previous tubal surgery, previous pelvic inflammatory disease, previous ectopic pregnancies, assisted reproductive techniques, as well as the presence of intrauterine contraceptive devices. In the physical examination, it is important to ensure hemodynamic stability. Patients with ectopic pregnancy are at high risk of ruptured or bleeding ectopic pregnancy, which may cause massive intra-abdominal blood loss and hemodynamic collapse. Palpation of the abdomen may reveal features of peritonism, involuntary guarding, as well as rebound tenderness. Adnexal tenderness or masses may be detected on vaginal examination. Mandatory investigations include a serum beta ECG level as well as an ultrasound of the pelvic organs. Suboptimal rises in beta ECG are commonly seen in ectopic pregnancies as previously mentioned. Ultrasound of the pelvis may reveal absence of an intrauterine gestation. Occasionally, adnexal masses may be seen and free fluid in the pouch of Douglas if the ectopic pregnancy has ruptured. Management of ectopic pregnancies may be divided into expectant, medical, and surgical, each with its own indications and criteria. Expectant management may be a consideration if the patient has minimal symptoms, there is no acute abdomen, serum beta ACG levels of less than 1,000, and falling, if the adnexal mass is less than 2 centimeters or undetected, in the absence of fetal cardiac activity, and the presence of reliable follow-up. Medical management refers to intramuscular methotrexate. Methotrexate is a chemotherapeutic drug which works by killing actively dividing cells. Criteria for medical treatment include stable vital parameters, few symptoms, no contraindication to methotrexate, unruptured ectopic, absence of fetal cardiac activity, adnexal mass less than 2 centimeters, serum beta ACG less than 3,000, and presence of reliable follow-up. Its advantages include convenience. It is administered as a single dose, it is safe, effective, and less costly than surgery. However, compliance to serum beta ACG training is necessary. This is performed at days 4 and 7 after the administration, and subsequently till the levels are less than 5 microunits per milliliter. Surgical management is the mainstay of treatment. Laparoscopy is the gold standard. Salpingostomy is performed specially when the contralateral fallopian tube is diseased or if fertility is to be preserved. Salpingectomy is performed when ectopic pregnancy is too large for tubal preservation or when fertility is not an issue. The patient has completed her family. Gestational trophoblastic disease. Gestational trophoblastic disease is a type of tumor of trophoblastic cells. It is rare, with an incidence of 1 out of 1,000 to 1 out of 1,500. Risk factors include previous gestational trophoblastic disease or pregnancies at extreme risk of reproductive life. There are several types of gestational trophoblastic diseases, and these include complete hydatidiform mole, incomplete hydatidiform mole, and choriocarcinoma. A complete hydatidiform mole is diploid and has a karyotype of 46XX or 46XY. Histology reveals hydropic villi with no fetal vessels and hyperplasia of trophoblastic tissue. The patient may present with pervaginal bleeding, abdominal pain, nausea, and vomiting. Examination findings may include a uterus that is larger than date, products of conception, or grape-like vesicles at the introitus, and evidence of pervaginal bleeding. Investigations should include serum beta HCG and an ultrasound scan of the pelvis. An incomplete hydatidiform mole, also known as a partial mole, is comprised of a triploid karyotype, 69XXY, 69XXX, or 69XYY. Histology reveals less hydrobic villi with some fetal vessels and less hyperplasia of trophoblastic tissue. Patients usually present with similar complaints, but examination usually shows a uterus smaller than date. Choriocarcinoma are malignant hydatidiform moles, which are aneuploid, comprised of an X or Y chromosome. Histology typically shows malignant cytotrophoblasts, cinctial trophoblasts without villi. In addition to the above-mentioned presenting complaints, patients may have symptoms of distant metastases at presentation. Examination shows a uterus larger than date and possibly signs of distant metastases. Investigation should include the evaluation of these distant metastases.
When approaching patients with suspected gestational trophoblastic disease, history taking should include details of pervaginal bleeding, lower abdominal cramps, as well as specific features pertaining to gestational trophoblastic disease, like passage of grape-like vesicles and excessive nausea and vomiting. On physical examination, the uterus is usually larger than the dates, and vaginal examination may reveal SID, grape-like vesicles. Investigational results which may indicate gestational trophoblastic disease include serum beta HCG at levels higher than expected, and ultrasound findings of a snowstorm cystic appearance as previously described. If an invasive hydatidiform mole is suspected, a chest X-ray as well as other radiological investigations should be performed to exclude metastases. In the management of benign gestational trophoblastic disease, an evacuation of uterus with serial trending of beta HCG till undetectable levels by 12 to 16 weeks should be performed. If a malignant gestational trophoblastic disease is diagnosed, chemotherapy and sometimes radiotherapy may be indicated.